Hey everyone, Corey from Aquarium Co-op. Getting started a few minutes early here, but you know, I finished all my work, answered all the emails and comments and things like that. Of course, I'm getting a call right now. Let me check, make sure that's not my store. It is my store, so give me a moment, please.
Hello, this is Corey.
What a horrible start to my live stream, but now we're going. So had a little, not emergency, but employees had questions on what to do in a situation. I had to answer it, and that's because I'm not there today. So that's how that gets started. Yeah, exactly. The store did just ask, when do I get started? It's like they knew. They probably thought like, oh, he doesn't go live for like 3 or 4 minutes. I can sneak this question in. And that's what I get for going live early. Who knew? But anyway. So today we're going to focus on aquarium circulation. All the questions are going to pertain to that. Maybe at the end we'll open it up to other things. But I want to try this format again now that we've got some labeling in the, you know, kind of below me here. There's some labeling on what we're going to talk about. So hopefully we don't get sidetracked until we open it up. So So go ahead and start asking the questions and I'll start answering. And, you know, first, why are we talking about aquarium circulation? It's one of the most important things, no matter what type of tank you're going to do, whether it's a planet tank, African cichlid tank, goldfish tank, doesn't really matter, salt water. It's important in different ways to every one of those. And so if it's just a fish-only tank, circulation is going to make a difference when it comes to moving food around and waste settling, things like that. We can direct currents. We can also just tire a fish out. You know, a lot of people say 10x, you know, water filtration per an aquarium. Well, that's great, except the way you set that up could be very dangerous. You can use a very small pump and move massive amounts of water if you do it correctly. Like if you set it up as a river tank, if I put a small pump on one side and it blows to the left or the right, whatever way you're looking at it. It blows to the other side, but then that water drops off and goes into a sump and comes back. It'll create a loop, and even at 100 gallons per hour, eventually that water is going to get moving pretty quickly. And so that's why we need to focus on the way we create circulation in an aquarium, even for just fish. For plants, it's important, so it's what's going to deliver nutrients to the plants. If we have stagnant water and we dose fertilizers, they're not going to get to all of our plants the way we want them to. Also, we tend to get bits of debris landing on plant leaves, which leads to algae and things like that. Salt water, we know it's very important to move everything around, especially if we have corals and stuff, filter feeders. There's, fresh water as well. There's filter feeders. So there's lots of reasons why we need to do it. And I think most people go by, do I have enough filtration? Not really thinking about how they actually set up an aquarium to do anything in particular. They just go, oh yeah, I have a number. That's right. So let's see if we can delve into some of these questions here. I got to get set up. Okay. How much flow per hour should you have? Michael asks. Well, the answer to that is there is no answer. So you have to specify what type of fish. So for instance, let's say we had a group of loaches. They can take a lot of flow. Or plecos. Plecos typically come from water that's so fast you couldn't stand it. If it was up to your knees, it'd be knocking you over. That's how fast that water moves. Now, even in the wild, there's still going to be nooks and crannies for these fish to rest. And so when you, let's say you were to make a river biotope like that and the water was just gushing, you'd still have rock or wood kind of as speed bumps for that water so that they could get back there and rest and sleep and things like that. But like my fancy goldfish tank behind me, the flow is actually pretty low, and that's because their bodies aren't really adapted to swim that well. African cichlids, you know, depending on what they are, can take quite a bit of flow. Like maybe a multi-shell dweller or other tangenicans don't take nearly as much flow as, you know, some trout cichlids are going to be huge. And usually the bigger the fish is, the more flow they can handle. And especially when it comes to like ponds, like koi and things like that. But if you guys have specific fish, we can talk about setting them up properly, because I think that's the problem, is everyone assumes one size fits all, and it's actually all different. And, you know, to put it in a different way, you might say, how often and how hard should I exercise my dog? And the answer would be, well, it depends on the dog. Is the dog 14 years old already? Is it a Great Dane? Is it a Jack Russell Terrier? And for some reason, that makes sense to everyone. But when it comes to fish, we kind of just lump them all together and go, what's the right number for fish? And so, yeah, I'm hoping this will be a little more in-depth based on people's needs. All right, I gotta make this window bigger. I cannot see this window with the current way it is. There we go. All right, so William Feltner, do I need an aquarium stone or an air stone even with tons of surface movement? In the terms of oxygen, we'd have to test it to really know. But in my tests, yes. In the terms of aquarium circulation, it's a pretty efficient piece of equipment. So in the tank behind me here, you see we've got, you know, an air stone going, and that's creating an uplift. And so when the water, well, so the air rises and it brings the water up with it. And what that's going to do is it's going to kind of create this circular motion over here and over here. So now we've got basically food and particles and whatever lands in this area being circulated. And what that's going to do is eventually it's going to find its way to my overflows and find its way into my filtration, which can be a good thing and a bad thing. So like right now, I've got a bunch of frozen brine shrimp in there because I just fed before I sat down. I don't necessarily want that making it to the overflow. So I could turn that pump off or something like that, or put it on a timer and turn it off for 30 minutes or something like that. But yes, I would say maybe the most efficient piece of equipment you can put into a tank is an air stone, because it is relatively gentle. The pattern is also random, and that's an important thing we can go over in a little bit too, is you don't want the pattern to always stay the same, because everything will always settle into a corner. So let's say you had three power heads and you've added them to increase circulation. It will increase it, but it'll just change the dead spot. So if you had a bunch of fish poop sitting here, you put in a power head here, so it whips that up. Turns out it just lands over here. And so the best thing you could do is have a random flow pattern. And saltwater is really good about this. They use wave makers, they use timers, things like that. We can accomplish the same thing in an aquarium, freshwater side, cheaply. Imagine I have that air pump, or two air pumps, or three power heads, or whatever it is, and I set them to different timers so that one of them's on for 4 hours, then for the next 4 hours, both of them are on, and then this one turns off, but this power head over here turns on. It's going to keep changing the currents in the tank so that nothing can really settle long term. So back to the original question, do you need an air stone? Need is a strong word. Would I use one? Definitely. And I have an air stone running in here and in the sump. Don't forget about your sumps for circulation and stuff like that too. Wherever there's water, you want to keep it moving. And it just helps fight off a lot of things, honestly. David asks, I was looking at circulation pumps because I have a dead spot. What size do I recommend for a 60-gallon aquarium? So in a 60-gallon aquarium, I would recommend multiple sources to move water around as opposed to just adding one. Because kind of like what I just said, if we add one, it's going to change the current in there, but you're just going to move the dead spot. And so if you break it up into two or three pieces, whether it's air stones, power heads, circulation pumps, extra filters, which I'm not a big fan of turning filters on and off, but you could. If you break it up into those pieces, you can get a truly, it's not random because there's technically a pattern, but you can put enough elements in there that it's almost random. And you could use wave makers and stuff like that, and that'd be a pretty expensive way to go. But I feel like adding, let's say, 300 gallon per hour ish pumps or air stones in a modular setting in a 60 gallon would be a good way to go. I've learned through just my tanks that I've had that bigger is not always better. I bought the Corallia Magnum 8, which is the biggest one they make. It's like 3,700 gallons per hour. And I had it in the shop tank with the guppies and the Mabu Puffer. Now, that tank didn't used to have guppies in it. It used to have other big fish and stuff. But it was so powerful that all the fish could not swim against it. And that, we're talking 2-foot fish were struggling. And it's because the water would just get moving so fast that in a 360-gallon tank, way too powerful. So I could turn it on. What I would do is I would turn it on for each day for like maybe an hour. It would really stir gunk up into the filters, which was nice. But it was way too powerful for the fish to swim against all the time unless I put a ton of wood and rock in there. And then I was taking up so much space, it wasn't worth it. So, you know, since then, I've learned I'd much rather have, instead of that Corallia 8, maybe I'd rather have, 5 1,000-gallon-per-hour power heads that I could play with. I think that would work better for my situations. And I think most people will find that too, and it would have been cheaper. Paul Martin, is it beneficial for a canister filter return to be vertical instead of the traditional horizontal? Well, it depends on what you're trying to accomplish. So let's say like a spray bar, if we have it right on the surface and it's blowing water out, the current, what's going to do, so pretending that my body is the back of the tank, the water's going to come out, roll down the front of the glass, and bring it back into an intake. And that can be a good thing. And it's probably the best way to set up a filter if that's the only filtration you have, is you get that broad sweeping motion. And that'll help collect things into a filter. Now, if you put it in vertically, you're going to be... So now we've got the spray bar up and down, and we're going to push that water straight against the front glass. It's going to hit it and kind of deflect to the sides. Now, that can get a motion going like this. But to really know which one is better... Just talking purely about flow, we'd have to know the decorations in the tank to know is that working well. So for instance, if the water was coming out this way, hits the front, hits the bottom, you got a big log right there, and the water just stops like it's a giant speed bump. Well, that's not so good either. But then let's say you're going around the corners and you've got the same problem. So you got to analyze your hardscape or what you're doing to know which is better. Now, if we factor in the fact that aimed up at the top might help with some surface agitation that helps with oxygen, that could be good. That being said, if you had air stones and things like that going, that would be kind of a non-issue. So that's how you kind of analyze. And I know it's kind of like saying, what fish get along? Will this fish do okay? You got to know what else is in the tank to know, is it just purely better or worse to which way you orientate the spray bar. Let's see here. Josh Aquatics. Gallons per hour... for a hang-on back filter for a 40-gallon planted tank. In my opinion, any amount, because the filtration itself isn't going to be very important. The plant should be doing it. Circulation's pretty important. I actually use air stones in my planted tanks because I like what they do. They keep the water well oxygenated, even during the night. And I have tanks that purl without injecting CO2 in the shop. You can come see them. So they're purling, plants are, couldn't be happier, and I have air stones going, but I'm not injecting CO2, and most people would say those two things can't happen. But really, you just want good flow, because one filter, if this is a tank, and you have an AquaClear 110, which would be a big filter for that 40 breeder, it might do really good on that one corner and leave this total side over here stagnant. So you might be better off with a few different smaller pieces of filtration and breaking it up that way. In fact, when I say might, I strongly believe you would be. So I don't think it's so much about how many gallons per hour. I think it's more about multiple sources of water movement, especially when you wanted to be delivering nutrients to those plants. So Chris Lawnwalter, flow in a 15-gallon, 48-inch guppy breeding tank, looking at powerhead on DIY water polisher. So 15 gallons and 4 feet long, it's going to be a pretty small, that might be like, I don't even know, like 8 by 8 by 8 or something. Like it's this long rectangle. But I would say you would need very little, you might use like what's called a hobbyist pump or something like that. 80 to 100 gallons per hour would be more than enough. But I think what you're going to find is on a 4-foot run, it's going to be hard to lift stuff up over here unless you created a situation otherwise. Because what happens with water, you push it one way, eventually it's going to hit something and bounce back. And so wherever it hits something, if it's that other glass wall, it's not going to really whip stuff up and get it back to the other side on a long run like that. So you might actually get better out of, let's say, 80-gallon per hour pump here and an 80-gallon per hour pump here and kind of get the water doing this motion. But putting in a couple of breaks so that fish can break and it's not just purely a lagoon that they're on the treadmill all the time. Let's see here. Nathan Springle. Corey, when you deal with the big tanks such as an 8-foot tank, what turnover would you recommend for a planted tank? And then the tank, in-tank circulation power heads. Well, I would say very little turnover. Like, plants should be doing most of the filtration. And then what we're using the filtration for is catching maybe physical debris. And so on an 8-foot tank, you know, maybe you break that into manageable sections. So think to yourself, how am I going to manage the waste in every 2-foot block? And that's why you'll see on 6-foot and 8-foot tanks, a lot of times they have cutouts in the back and things every 2 feet or so. And maybe you put just a hang-on back on each one, or a canister filter maybe on a 4-foot section or a 2-foot section. And then as far as circulation in the tank, my best metric that I like to use in a planted tank is, are all the leaves on every plant moving? They don't have to be, you know, moving really fast, but just slightly moving. If it's moving at all, you know water is going by those plant leaves. And if you see dead spots, you know, okay, we're not getting very good nutrient delivery to that area. And, you know, tying back in, I recommend using timers and extra circulation pumps to fix that. Now, in a planted tank, you get some bonuses by putting them on timers, because if you run, a circulation pump going all the time, eventually it's going to suck in a leaf or something, and that leaf's going to stay there till it rots or you remove it. Well, if it's on a timer, it turns off. Sometimes that leaf falls back off and can make its way somewhere else and doesn't inhibit that pump. So I would say circulation, very important. Make it modular. The actual filtration of the tank, that's kind of what plants are doing, and I use it, filtration, for mechanical filtration, not so much biological. So even though I do put biological on my tanks, I don't focus on it nearly as much as mechanical. And so that's when you look down, like in the sump behind me, you'll go, well, there's not even that many bio rings and stuff. It's mostly just floss to polish the water, and that's definitely true. I'm mostly just using it to floss the tank or clean it. Villager Sparky, what kind of flow and filter do I recommend for a basic red cherry shrimp tank and a 2.5 gallon betta tank? I feel it is a bit too small for shrimp, but right now that's what you've got. I would order a very, very small sponge filter, and they make some that are like, I don't have anything on my desk that's the size of it, but you know, let's say it's like that big around and like this tall. So they're very small. They should be under $5. And the airflow will be gentle, because it's easy to create a tornado in a 2.5 gallon. I mean, you're kind of aware of that. It's very small. But a seasoned sponge filter will give you pretty decent flow. And yes, could you, you know, you're going, well, shouldn't you use multiple points of sources of water movement? Yes, but it's going to be very difficult to pull that off in such a small tank without creating just a tornado of movement. So I would say that's probably the best you can do, is a random flow pattern from an airstone, or not an airstone, but a sponge filter. Let's see here. Scuba Steve, how much flow do I prefer discus tanks to have? Trying to think about that. For discus tanks, the flow that I prefer is an uplifting flow. And so not so much left to right flow, you know, but what I want to do is, when I'm, let's say I'm feeding frozen bloodworms and things like that, I want something to be continually lifting the food off the ground if I can. And so especially while I'm feeding, I like it if I've got lots of extra aeration. And in general, running hot water and stuff like that with discus, I use a lot of airstones anyway. And I guess while I'm talking about airstones, I should say that primarily, I'm always using either sponge filters or like the Neverclog airstones that are weighted, you know, and like with these goldfish, they love to eat off the bottom, and I let them do that, and they clean the gravel for me. But if I didn't want anything to land, I might have 5 or 6 airstones going in there and just, you know, gentle, always flow going upwards. And I might have a couple of them on a timer, you know, if I know that I feed at 6 o'clock every night, I have it on for an hour, and that second air pump kicks back off after about an hour or so, so it's not constantly swimming. Because part of the reason, or part of the problem with a lot of movement, it builds a lot of muscle mass. That's kind of good, but it also burns a lot of energy. And so if a fish is constantly having to swim, you might go, okay, discus already have a high metabolism. We're keeping the water temperature warm. and then we're forcing them to swim all the time, you might have to feed twice as much as you normally do just to keep the same weight on them if you're forcing them to exercise it off all the time. And that becomes especially important with fry and things like that when you're trying to grow a fish. But those are my general tips of, I want uplifting flows on discus personally. And I don't know what's going on with this webcam, like why it's... I installed software for my webcam, and it keeps like changing the color. I can see it on video of like, you know, the wood and stuff. I think it's trying to color correct, but it keeps going back and forth. And I think it's based on where I am at. So I'll try to figure that one out for the next live stream. But anyway, you know, like this video if you haven't already. Share it if you haven't already. We'll keep going. Kerpel4, what would be a good way to get rid of protein buildup on the surface of the water using circulation? So the easiest way, airstone. When it pops, it's going to break that film. The other best way is to have water cascading down into it. So when you have that protein film on, if you can get water coming down to pull it back in, we get additional chances for our filtration to break it down. We pull it back into the filter, we run it through a couple of times. This is assuming it's fresh water. With salt water, you'd use a protein skimmer, and in fresh water, you could use a surface skimmer, and that helps, but it's doing the same thing. We're pulling that protein off the top of the water and trying to get it back into the water to pull it out with some filtration. Ben Brevis. How significant of a factor is water flow when dealing with preventing blue-green algae? That one could be debated about a lot. I feel like, in general, the more flow you have, the less likely you are to get blue-green algae. And the best way to get rid of blue-green algae is to overall improve your tank and the way it's set up in terms of flow, in terms of cleaning, and things like that. We can kind of make some generalizations that a cleaner tank tends to get blue-green algae less often. You know, it tends to start where there's a slow spot in a tank and where a bunch of gunk is built up. And I don't know, you know, no one really knows what really exacerbates the blue-green algae. You know, there's thoughts on not enough phosphate. There's thoughts on too much phosphate, too much nitrate, not enough nitrate. So that's all still being debated. But in general, I find it's maintenance neglected tanks or dead spots and things like that that I typically see it first, and then it kind of spreads from there. So I would say that, you know, the more you have, the better it is, while maintaining that the fish can handle it and the plants are handling it and things like that. Freshwater fix. Should I have a circulation pump for my Jack Dempsey's, not for the tank circulation, but for them to swim against? It can be a pretty good thing. So like with Jack Dempsey's, let's say you want to curb some aggression and things like that. Think of it like a dog. If I take my dog out for a walk 3 times a day, when he comes home, he's more likely to lay around the house and be relaxed instead of just running around with his head, you know, chopped off. Same thing with that Jack Dempsey. If you give him something to swim against, he's going to tire himself out. He'll also build some more muscle, which makes him stronger, which could be good or bad. But yeah, in general, I would say, yeah, it could be a good thing. And maybe you have that thing kick on for 4 to 6 hours a day, and then it goes off. And by the way, I don't recommend your highest flows ever being when the lights are out. Typically, fish are trying to rest and things like that. Now, there are some exceptions, nocturnal fish, but things like Jack Dempsey's, you can have quite a bit of flow, especially for them because they're a cave dweller typically. When they're tired of swimming, they're going to go back into their cave. So it works out pretty good for things like that. Let's see. Charles McMack. Is it better for the delivery of oxygen into the water if you have the water level a few inches below the hang-on back so water falls into your tank? In my testing, yes, that was better. That being said, I could make a case for maybe water is overall better if you have 3 more inches of water, and an airstone was really effective. So I personally would rather go, okay, I can get 10 more gallons of water, which overall increases my tank volume by, you know, X percent, and then put an airstone in and get the best of both worlds. That's how I would probably tackle that problem myself. Let's see here. iCool guy, what is the best type of airstone, long bar type or small ball type? I would say it depends on how strong your pump is. With most people buying kind of off-the-shelf hobbyist pumps,
I would say a smaller one is better. Like a big, long air stone, it takes a lot of air to run that efficiently. And even so, like with the Neverclog air stone that I sell, I like these better than the ball ones. Like I think I've got one over here. Like this ball one right here, it's made of either ceramic or sintered glass. You know, there's a few other things I can make them out of, but eventually the pores get clogged and it's going to create back pressure on that pump. And you probably have worked with air stones before, and you know, like, yeah, I get 6 or 8 months maybe, and then they either become brittle and break or they just stop putting out as good of a flow. And like with a Neverclog air stone, you can take it apart, you know, you could clean it, not that it ever really gets dirty, and it's already weighted, which this one isn't. And it does create more coarse bubbles for sure, but that is so that it creates less back pressure on the actual pump itself, where this creates much finer bubbles, which are more efficient. I don't deny that. But it also leads to a harder life and a hotter running pump. And in general, you get less overall flow in terms of back pressure from this and this. You might go, well, this one I can run on a 100-gallon tank with the same pump. This thing I can only run on a 50 or 30-gallon tank because of the back pressure from the water depth. So, but I would say, you know, do what you want first. If you want that big, long bubble wall, buy enough pumps to make it happen, but realize it takes a lot, and you're going to need, you know, to replace that air stone pretty frequently to get a good flow out of it. Chewy Bros, what's the best circulation for a small, shallow, outdoor pond? I would say a sponge filter. If you were just going to pick a thing, an air stone, like my pond, 110 gallons, I'm running just an air stone. Most times I run a sponge filter. If I have one kicking around, I just throw the sponge filter in there, call it good. You know, and that's, I should say, we're saying it's a small, shallow pond that works. Now, if we're talking about a shallow pond, but it's like 10,000 gallons, but shallow, that's a completely different scenario than what I'm envisioning of, like, you know, a pond as big as this tank or smaller or something like that. Kizmath. Your 40-minute video covering sponge cancer and filters was fantastic. Yeah, you guys should check it out. If you haven't already, you know, there's that whole video on filtration. And I, you know, a lot of people are saying, you didn't mention all these things about what I consider to be circulation. So that's why we're doing this kind of talk now, is in my opinion, this is much different than physically converting ammonia into nitrates. That's a whole different process than making sure nutrients get delivered to plants. We pick up debris off the ground, things like that. Two different purposes. Let's see here. So Mr. Hmong Culture says, what kind of filter won't suck up guppy fry? You need intake sponges. So basically anything that has suction can suck things up. Let's, you know, assume that's true. So even a sponge filter, like let's say I got this thing on my desk. Let's say I had this J-tube and I put an air stone right here at the bottom of it and air went up and came out over here. It would suck water and fish up into this. Now, with this currently the way it's set up, it wouldn't do any harm. But if I had an impeller on this side, it would grind them up, right? So we just put a sponge intake on it. Now, where it sucks in the water, it can't suck up anything bigger than what the pores are of the sponge. And so, yeah, this is a pretty big one in this example here. But there are smaller ones. I sell on my website. You can get them a few other places. But if you're purely just breeding guppies, maybe use just a sponge filter. That's going to be fry safe. If you already have hang-on backs or canisters, putting a sponge on the intake is going to help. That's the way I would. You can also use nylon and nets and stuff like that, but they get clogged up pretty quick and can restrict the flow. And that's one of the most asked questions is, does an intake sponge restrict flow? Only if you're neglecting it or you have an inadequately sized one. If I have a giant canister filter and I have a sponge filter this big on it, it's going to clog up in like 20 minutes. So that would harm it. So you want to go bigger instead of smaller. Aquaman, sponge filter in a planet tank or canister filter? I've done both. I would say sponge filter works just as good. If you know you're injecting CO2 and stuff like that, maybe you want to use a canister filter, but I find most people with a canister filter, and this is just most, out of sight, out of mind. I would much rather service my sponge filter once a week or the sponge on the intake of that canister once a week than break that whole canister filter down every week. And, you know, that tends to be labor intensive, and I tend not to do it as often as I probably would or should do it. But if you're just asking which one's better, they're completely equal. Watch the aquarium filtration video. Pick one that works for you. Nathan Springle, if someone has an 8-foot tank that is 36 inches deep, which would be very deep, what would you recommend for tank circulation? The tank is 375 gallons with angelfish. Combination of air stones and circulation pumps. I would probably have the circulation pumps. If this, let's pretend this is 8-foot tank, 3 feet deep. I'd put circulation pumps kind of down low in a corner, and I would have them point up to like the opposite corner. And I, you know, assuming there wasn't plants there, because I don't want to suck all the plants into it. If I did have a bunch of plants along the bottom, then I would use air stones to kind of lift stuff up out of here. Because if I put a circulation pump like right back here, it would suck this crinum natans into it. And so this air stone doesn't have a super strong lift, and so it's not sucking that in. But you can see right here, it's still moving around. And this is what I'm talking about in a planet tank, where you want to see stuff moving. This is all I have in here is one air stone and the return from the sump. Now you can see everything's moving over here. I'm not really doing a very good job, and I could, and maybe I will remedy it. But if we look at the other side here, mostly nothing is moving. You see, like, it's a little bit moving, but I really should have this moving more. And so if you break that 8-foot tank up into kind of 2-foot sections and digest it each one, you'll get a much better tank going. And so you can see here, this is, you know, a little more than 4-foot tank. I think it's 5-foot. But we've got like relatively 1/2 or 2 feet of it moving pretty good, really. And then that other 3 feet that's not so good. And you would think it would do better because the overflow is right here, so all the water is going that way. But it's not a random pattern, and it finds its channels, and it just doesn't do that well. William Feltner, have you ever thought about doing a review on the Sun canister filters? I could. Part of the problem is there's nothing for me to gain from it. And I know that sounds weird, but in my opinion, they're low quality, you know, so they're not super high quality, but that's okay. They are cheap. I don't sell them. I don't even really recommend canister filters that much besides specific situations, and it's already been done to death. Like, I think I could pull up 50 different videos on Sun canister filters, and so my review wouldn't be that different. And if I was going to use a canister filter, there's other ones I would use, and you're going to say, have you ever used one? Yes, I have. You know, why don't you use more? Because I don't feel they're the best, so I don't. And so that's why I probably won't do that review. I'm not going to say I'll never do it, but that's why it's not on the high priority list. You know, I've considered bringing them in from China, just buying them direct from a manufacturer, but even then, I'm still like, why compete with everyone else? The product's already out there. It's already, you know, there's not very much profit margin in it. Why dedicate time and resources and energy when I could do it in a slightly different direction, you know, like another live stream or something, and get much better results for the public, being that, you know, I might help way more people with this live stream than I help with a Sun review, because not many people have talked in depth about aquarium circulation where there's 50 different videos on the Sun filter, so. Shout out to Michael Sternick he sent me some Mountain Dew, so sponsored by Michael Sternick today. Mr. G, I have a 60-gallon planet tank, Eheim Classic internal, 200 liter per hour, and an internal. Do I think you should add an air stone as well? Yes, I do. I have this weird belief that every single aquarium should always have an air stone, or an air source, whether it's a sponge filter, something like that. And in my experience, I've just found that it always is beneficial to me. And people will say, well, you're gassing off the CO2 and you're doing this and you're doing that. Well, what about all the good things you're doing too? And realize, people always say with an air stone, like, you're gassing off all the CO2. If you use up all your CO2 in a planted tank, the air that is coming in from that air stone would actually be diffusing CO2 back into the water. People always forget that part. They forget that normal breathing air has some CO2 in it. We're going to inject that in there. It's going to actually bring some back in if your tank is running out. And they always discount that fact, which I'm not going to say that fact happens all the time. But for me, I find an air stone very beneficial to planted tanks personally. Let's see. All right, cool guy. My angels get pushed off by the output filter, by the output of your filter, but they keep going there. Should I do something about it? It seems like there is something because they keep pecking at it. 2 juveniles and a 40-gallon. Well, a lot of times algae or I mean, angelfish will eat algae, and they might be just pecking some of the algae off the outflow there. But you'd have to identify the source. I would say so long as they've got a quiet corner to go into and they're choosing to go over there, that's on them. You know, it's kind of like you got a sprinkler in your yard and you go, why do those kids keep going over there? It's cold water and it's not even that warm out today. Because they want to. They can clearly go inside and not be cold. And the same thing, those angelfish, if they got a quiet corner to go to, they're choosing to go do that. Then it's just figuring out why they're doing it if you want to curb that behavior. And you might go, oh, they're just eating a little bit of algae off the filter. Or maybe that's where bits of food are coming out because you don't have a pre-filter sponge where it's sucking it up. Let's see here. Kai Burgess asks, the Fluval G3 and G6 comes with a conductivity tester. Do you ever test conductivity in my tanks? I do check for TDS, yes. It can be useful outside of normal testing, I guess. So, like, especially if a customer comes in, they're like, I don't get it. My water's not doing things. Fish are dying. I don't know what's going on. And all the tests come back great. And then you start pulling up TDS, and you're like, well, this is kind of odd. And do I test it very often? No. I used to use it a lot more. But now that I have auto water change systems, my water parameters stay so, like, on point that I don't need to. But, yes, it was a nice way to kind of test a bunch of tanks. And if you know, like, okay, my cherry shrimp always breed awesome at 220 TDS, and you go and you test and you're like, oh, I'm at 150, or I'm at 400 and they're not breeding very well, you know, okay, I probably need to change water and address this issue. But it's a quick measurement tool, and I'm not certain that it's good to use all the time. Because if I tell you, like, oh, cherry shrimp breed at 220 TDS for me, that has no bearing on your own water. My TDS could be all from calcium. Your TDS could be all from nitrates, for instance. So that it's a loose cannon in the fact that it's a quick measurement, but it doesn't discern really what you're measuring for. Which, I don't know why I answered that question. It's not really a flow question. But in general, I do hate the G3 and G6. I think they're incredibly overpriced for what they do. Esoteric Aquatics, how does water flow affect plants? Well, most plants get their nutrients out of the water, and if we have water be stagnant, they're not getting fresh nutrients. And so if we move water around, when we put liquid fertilizer in the water, you know, so if I grab this off the top, and let's say I put, you know, a squirt, you know, three squirts right here into this tank, if there's no movement, it would never move. You'd have to wait for a fish to swim by to mix it up a little bit. So if we have movement, now it, you know, if I squirt it in, it's going to travel and it might make it all the way through this plant, and that's a good thing, and that's what you want. Also, it's going to keep debris from landing on the plants, which debris, when it lands on a plant, it's going to block some of the light. And that's going to make it photosynthesize a little bit less. It's also gives it a good environment for algae to start growing. So those are the main ways it helps a planet tank. Let's see here. David Reynolds, sorry if you covered it. I came in a bit late. Do I recommend air stones for shrimp? I recommend air stones for every aquarium. I'm trying to think if there's an aquarium I don't recommend air stones for. Besides crazy stuff. Like, I don't recommend one for jellyfish tanks. I'm trying to think of another scenario I don't. I mean, I'm sure there's some where I'm like, oh, that would be bad. But in general, I think I always want an air stone just because they're cheap, they're efficient, and they do more than just add oxygen. You know, they're flow, and they're just good. Let's see. What is the best filter for a betta in a 10-gallon tank to keep the tank clean without upsetting the betta? I'm using the ATI-2 sponge, any flares at it when pushed around, airflow is low. Well, the flow is not low enough. You know, you could literally have it where it's like a bubble comes out every, you know, 30 seconds. So if your betta is being blown around, the flow is just too high. You know, it's kind of one of those, in a vacuum, if you say bettas don't like to be flung around and your filter's doing it, clearly it's too strong. And it has nothing to do with the like the filter itself. So whether you have an ATI-1 or an ATI-5 or an ATI-2 sponge filter, it's all about the flow coming out of that, and that's all driven by your air pump, which you could use a fine little tuning valve to turn that down quite a bit, which I do recommend. A more gentle current if you put an air stone in there. So in the ATI sponge filters, and I've shown this in other videos, you can put an air stone inside of it. That's why I like them so much, and that'll create a much more gentle, even current than blub, 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 and kind of, you know, rocky. So that's my recommendation, is turn the flow down on the air pump. Kenny Kirk asks, how do you service a sponge filter to squeeze it? Well, you would take it out into a bag, and you would clean it there, and you'd keep getting water from the tank until it came out clean, and then you'd put it back in, get your water change done also. I'm just touching on that because I've been talking about sponge filters so much, even though it's not an aquarium circulation question. Let's see. Matt from Cali. I wanted to ask about freshwater sumps and CO2. If I do a sump, will I lose a lot of pressurized CO2? Is a canister better? That doesn't really pertain to circulation. But in general, are you going to lose a lot? No. Are you going to lose more than if you didn't have one? Yes. Are you going to have to maybe bump it up a bubble or two more per second? Yeah, sure. But lots of planted tanks run sumps. Let's see. Freshwater fix. Wave makers versus circulation pumps. They're actually the same thing. It's just whether the pump is designed to turn on and off all the time and whether you have the controller to do it. Now, you know, I'm trying to think, like, is one necessarily better or worse? I don't think so. You know, the goal is to keep water always moving. And, like, with wave makers, they're designed to make sure all the corals are moving. But we're doing the same thing in freshwater. We're trying to make sure all those leaves are moving. And, yes, is it easier with a wave maker to do that? It is easier, but it also costs a lot more money. And so, just in general, the saltwater hobby is willing to spend a lot more than the freshwater hobby is. So, you know, I would say they're relatively equal. And that's why you'll see a lot of times, like, the Corallia pumps and stuff like that, they're sold as a circulation pump, but then you can add the wave maker to it and it becomes a wave maker system. So they're really the same thing. It's mostly how you're actually utilizing them. Yeah, I know. I know Paul's saying that my camera, you know, is down a bit. But the problem is this mic. This mic, you know, if I drop it down more, now it's even more worse. So, you know, I could move it up a little bit, but then you're getting some of that, you know. I need to work on this, and I haven't dedicated time to fix, you know, the look of this, so to speak. See, now it's all jacked up, and I need to really play with it. And it takes like a day. Like, people think, like, yeah, you just move it. Like, no. You really gotta, like, now that I've moved it, now you're like, oh, this thing's gonna drive me nuts. Like, that thing is all, you know, so now maybe I gotta move it in a little bit. See, now I'm all off track, but that's why I don't do this on camera. So I'm just gonna go with that. Going with that, moving on. Let's see here. Also, I have to stay close to the microphone if you want really good audio. Like, if I'm up here, the audio is not gonna be as good, and conversely, if I'm back here, so it's a limitation of equipment, you know, and this isn't the most expensive mic, but it was still expensive, and I wish it was a little bit shorter, and I'm working on that, going, okay, can I buy a different mount, that type of thing. Anyway, Banana Bus asks, best filtration for a 30-gallon dwarf cichlid tank? That's a different video. We're talking about circulation. Villager Sparky, Corey, have I heard of a Small World filter by Penplex? It's an air-powered filter that uses cartridges. It seems like an interesting design, but the cartridges feel like a stupid idea. Yeah, I've used them. Well, I won't say I've used them. I sold them in a store I worked at. They're okay. I mean, I like the fact that it uses air. That's a decent design for sure. But the cartridge system is just bad in general. Like, they come with a piece of sponge in them, I think, also. And I'd rather, I just hot rod them with sponge. It's way better. And so at that point, once you've hot rodded with sponge, why wouldn't you just use a sponge filter? So, Steamfod Aquatics, have I seen the new Seachem hang-on backs? I haven't seen them, but I know they're working with Ceche, so it's just going to be a ripoff of the Ceche products. And in general, Ceche hasn't been that good for me for product-wise. They had problems in production, and they didn't have very good customer service, so I pretty much dropped their line of stuff. I do like their circulation pump. They have a very efficient, good circulation pump, but their canisters and things like that definitely left stuff to be desired. And in my opinion, personally, Seachem is a great chemical company and bad at everything else. So, like, you know, their foods and things like that. And that it's always goes back to my rant of every company does something really well, and then they go, well, we're doing this well. What if we did all the things well? And no one does all the things well ever. I think it's smart they're trying to partner up with CJ, because at least CJ makes equipment, but, you know, it remains to be seen. Look at Fluval. Fluval makes good filtration, but they pretty much make terrible fish food and things like that, and their plant fertilizers and stuff. Like, everyone wants to be the best at everything, and it's the same reason I only do freshwater and pretty much planted community tanks, because if I try and do it all, I'm going to end up being crappy in most things. Let's see. Unicorn Rose asks a question that's not about anything we're talking about. Kenny asks, do I think having an airstone and a hang-on back would be beneficial? I imagine it would work similar to a wet-dry. It doesn't work similar to a wet-dry. It does improve the circulation in there, and it can be a way to add oxygen to an aquarium without putting it into the display tank. That being said, I would like the benefits of the display tank to have the flow. You can see here, I've got something moving. What is that? Oh, it's a piece of Java fern that's come loose, a little baby plant from that plant over there. And so that's another in a planet tank. That's going to eventually find a slow spot and start growing there. That's what nature does. Let's see here. Kai asks, is it worth to have an air stone behind a matten filter that includes filter media to avoid channeling? Yeah, I would say it is. You would have to, you know, make sure it's an even spread, and you might have to move it or turn different air stones on or off at a certain time. But realize that, yeah, matten filters do collect a lot of gunk behind them typically, and you want to get that out of there. And one of the easiest ways would have it shoot it back out into the aquarium and then, you know, consume it a different way. Like, let's say you take it out with a water change because you're vacuuming the gravel or something like that. Let's see. Adam Till, the Marina check valves I bought for my sponge filter seem to have a lot of added back pressure. Anything better? I'm not sure there's going to be any check valve that doesn't have less back pressure, but also is reliable. Like, it needs that back pressure to keep the water from coming back in. So the best way would be like in my fish room where we run all the air up high. You do the same thing. If your pump is higher than the aquarium, you wouldn't need a check valve. And so that would be a way to maximize your efficiency. But in your situation at your house, that might not work out for you. You might go, oh, it's going to look ugly or whatever. There's always reasons. But maybe it makes sense. You know, that's one of those things that it might make more sense to buy a bigger pump and deal with the back pressure than, you know, redo the entire thing. But, you know, each individual situation is different. Let's see. Paul Martin, when I was in Japan, the filtration return was coming from under the substrate. Is that type of return optimum for circulation, better than an airstone? I'm not sure it's better than an airstone. I haven't played with it, so I hesitate to say, is this better or worse? Some of the things it does do really well is it's going to keep that section of sand very clean of debris. So, in you know, that's another source of circulation, is that would be very circulating very well. I suspect you might get some fine filtering out of that sand. It might also work like a fluidized sand bed in a little bit of a way. But I would be hard pressed to say, is it better than an airstone? I think it does something different. You know, maybe if I was comparing it to, do I think it's better than your vertical or horizontal spray bar idea? I don't know that it's better. I think it'd be worse than either one of those. But I think it gives a visual effect that's very neat. And so if I'd factor that in, maybe I choose that, realizing that I would still enhance the, not filtration, but the movement of the tank in other ways also. Let's see here. Matt Kelly, flow question. Good. Keeping it on flow. I like that. Why do hobbyists use a spray bar for circulation? I see them on outlet filters a lot lately. Mostly because it allows you to cover a greater area. So what that means is, like right now, I'm going the wrong way here. I'm trying to look into the camera and show you guys. So right now, I have my outlet from my sump. It's just a piece of PVC. It's a T, and it's coming straight out, right? And I should do a video on this. I keep putting it off. But if I make a spray bar, let's imagine I had a spray bar that now went the whole length of here. What would it do? It would slow down some of the flow over here, which maybe that's just fine because maybe the airstone's covering that. And it would increase some flow over here. Now, that being said, the further you stretch it, the lower the flow would be. But it might be that if, oh man, if I stretch that out 2 feet, now I might have good flow 3/4 of my tank. So that's why most people do it. Well, that's not true. That's not true at all. Most people do it because they saw someone else do it. Most people don't actually go, oh, let me analyze this and make this decision on my own. They go, people recommended that. Most of these people know more than I do, or I believe them, so I will do it. But most people don't arrive at the situation of, I should do this because I actually need it. Because if they did, you know, most people wouldn't need to ask that question, stuff like that. So, but yes, that's what it accomplished. It spreads out, you know, if I have 1,000 gallons per hour coming out right here, and I spread it out now over 3 feet, now each foot has, you know, 333 gallons per hour roughly, and that, you know, might be better. Also, it's a slower flow. So if one of my goldfish swims in front of that return, it might go, whoa, I just got pushed really hard. And if you had lots of longfin fish and goldfish and bettas and things like that, that could be bad. Angelfish, if you spread it out, it's a lot less flow in any one spot. Also, with a spray bar at the top, it's going to create surface agitation over a large area, which can help marginally change your gas exchange rate. It's kind of a long question or long answer to that question. Let's see here. John Martinez, can dead spots be placed purposely to collect waste for pickup and rest spots for the fish? Definitely. A lot of people, like on monster fish tank or monster fish keepers, and things like that where they run bare bottoms. The goal is to collect all the waste at one point, and then they can either siphon it out, or imagine this whole aquarium, all the flow went towards the overflow that's in this corner. If I could get every speck of waste that ever was in this aquarium to that corner, it would end up in my sump where I'm filtering out all the solids, and I would just have to, you know, take it out from there. Would make maintenance a lot easier, but it would take quite a bit of flow for me to get everything off the ground all the way to the top of the aquarium and there. So there are ways that people put like the intake for a sump or a canister filter very close to the bottom and just herd all that waste into that corner and just get sucked up in there. So yeah, you could totally use it to your advantage, and that's the right way to think, is how can I make my overall system better either with what I have or very slight adjustments and things like that. Let's see. Scuba Steve asks, why don't I like canister filters? I don't like them for discus tanks, but I'm curious to hear my opinion. I feel like for the dollar invested, the returns are very low. So if we know that, let's say, an FX6 canister filter holds, I'm just going to pick a number and say 5 gallons worth of media. I can buy 5 gallons worth of sponge filters for under $100. So that's 1/3 of the price, and I'll get about the same thing out of it. That being said, you know, I'd much rather have, let's say, 10 sponge filters that if one of them failed somehow, I've got 9 more. If that FX6 fails, my whole system crashes. Likewise, when the power goes out, there's no access to oxygen in a canister filter. So power goes out, it's trapped in its own bucket, it runs out of oxygen, let's say in 30 minutes, power comes back on, shoots a bunch of dead bacteria and ammonia into your tank, and you've got nothing to keep it alive. Now, sponge filters and things like that, they will consume oxygen out of the aquarium. And so yes, everything would have to run out of oxygen for this sponge to run out of oxygen. And typically, in a power outage situation, people can put a battery-powered airstone or something in their tank, but they don't do anything with their canister filter, and so they end up having to re-mini-cycle their tank, and the heavier load is, the harder that's going to be. Also, just from a guy that owns a store and has sold insane amounts of canister filters, most people go, well, yeah, I don't really clean that as much as I should. Takes kind of a long time. It hurts my back. I spill water every time I do it. There's all these reasons on why they don't clean it. And, you know, my biggest reason is an FX6 might take me 30 minutes to clean, and I swear the whole time doing it, going, dang it, I just spilled water out, dang it. Whereas, let's say the intake sponge on that same filter or smaller filters takes me less than 5 minutes, might take me 2 minutes. And I do that way more frequently than I do on a canister filter. So that's my main beef. Also, I don't feel like you're investing all that money, you get nearly as good a flow in an aquarium as if you made it modular. I'd much rather, honestly, I'd rather have like 3 Aqua 10-1 clears on this tank behind me than the sump I have. But it was already designed this way before I got it. There's no cutouts for any hang-on backs or anything like that. So I'm limited to what I have to use because that's the way it was designed. Yeah, I could router out things, stuff like that, but that's too much work, and that work skews why I would do it. All right, let's move on here. Adam Teal, full-length spray bar on tank with coast-to-coast overflow, suggested best location, up high for good surface turbulence, but collects algae. I would say, with a coast-to-coast overflow, and for what people, if people don't know what that is, that means your overflow, where the water overflows and goes down to a sump, goes all the way from side to side. So you have, you know, like on this one, it'd be 5 feet of flow. It's not going to give you any better surface agitation because your overflow should be doing that the whole time. It should be maximizing that out already. So it would actually, in my opinion, better to have that return be much lower in the tank. Now, why people don't do that typically is when the power goes out, your return turns into a siphon. So you'd have to make sure that you drill some holes in the return high enough so that it will break the siphon if the power was to go out. But that's why most people don't do it. And most people don't have a coast-to-coast overflow, so they can utilize it. Krishna says, hey, Corey's from London. Great, glad you could make it. Setting up a planet tank gravel with sand cap, how important is circulation in substrate with that substrate combo? Well, you're already going to be at a disadvantage because that sand eventually is going to work its way down through the gravel because that's just what it does. That's what sand does. But how important is it? It's decently important. Most people don't do it. But there's a few plant people I know that actually use undergravel filter plates, and they run, you know, them so that the water keeps going through the roots, and it makes it really easy to deliver aquarium fertilizer, like liquid fertilizer, to plant roots because it keeps going through those roots. Now, most people just said, oh, Corey, you're insane, you're crazy. Yeah, but these people are master aquatic horticulturists that grow some of the best plants you've ever seen. And it's not like they're saying this is the only way to do it. They just say, I feel like my tanks, in my experience, do much better with an undergravel filter plate with gravel in these planted tank scenarios than they do without one. They're not saying it's mind-blowingly different or you couldn't do it without it. It's just in their experience, they like it and say it does very well for them. Now, I've played with it some, and I'm on the fence on, does it make enough of a difference to even talk about? I was thinking about it just the other day, like I should play with that some more because I do feel like there is something to it, but I haven't investigated enough yet to know if it's a game changer, so to speak. But back to the original question, how important is circulation and substrate? I wouldn't say it's super important. There's other ways to do it. Like in the cichlid world, people use what's called a undergravel jet, and that's just pieces of PVC that picks up stuff off the ground, stuff like that, but I would say just good flow overall, and yes, substrate being part of it is a good idea, you know. It's kind of like one of those things saying, you know, is it better to turn the light off in here if I just go to the bathroom real quick and come back? Technically, yes, but it's a practical situation of like, oh, well, if you're going to be back in 30 seconds, like, it doesn't really make that much of a difference, and I think that's the same way here without me fully testing it. Chow, I hope I said that right. Would having a broadleaf plant such as Java Fern near an airstone be a good idea? Yeah, it could be fine. Yeah, there's no reason not to. It would increase circulation there and help deliver nutrients to it. And Java Fern's a water column feeder, so that would help. Yeah, I think it could only improve it. Lord Mugat says, what would I recommend canister intake return configuration for a 29-gallon cube? I'm having some issues with water flow in your current setup. We'll start out by, let's assume that I can only work with those pieces of equipment, okay? Let's just assume that. The best scenario I can think of is an intake as low as possible in one corner without picking up sand if you have sand substrate. And then ideally would be in the opposite back corner. No, that's not true. Yeah, in the opposite back corner. So intake as low as we can go, opposite corner, you put the return, and it's going to bounce off the front panel of glass, but at an angle to get that sweeping motion this way. That's the best way I think you could set up just one canister filter in a tank like that. You know, if it's all of a sudden like, well, I could add an airstone, I would say, okay, well, then do that and then add an airstone. Clearly, it's better. But if I'm limited to one piece of equipment, that's how I would set up that piece of equipment. This ties into what I was just talking about. I didn't realize. Dan Shaw, what do I think about an underground filter as well as regular filter that would improve circulation evenly? I actually do feel like an underground filter does improve circulation. If you have very strong air stones, with very mild air stones, you're going to get a lot of channeling. And what that means is, so imagine you have brand new gravel, there's no fish poop in it. As time goes on, fish poop's going to settle, let's say, here. Well, now water's not really going to go through there. It's going to go around it because this is clogged up. And the longer that goes, the more clogged up it gets. Now, the faster that flow you have coming out of there, the harder it would be to clog that up between your maintenance. Now, that's kind of why a lot of people switch to reverse flow underground filters. So we pumped water down through there and up to the gravel to make sure the gravel didn't collect anything. But the reason that I would say the reason that fell out of favor was it was ugly. All those big power heads at the top looked bad. And then also it only works on certain fish like African cichlids and goldfish and stuff like that. If they can make a hole down to the filter plate anywhere in that tank, it's rendered all of that useless. So in certain tanks, like a planted tank, in, you know, tanks where you're just breeding guppies or, you know, any fish that aren't digging really well, it could be used, and I say could be used very effectively. And I would not say underground filters should get nearly the hate they do get. You know, if you were to tell someone you have an underground filter plate, they just tell you, oh, you're clearly a moron or an idiot, when really that's not the case. In fact, a lot of very, very high-end fish farm breeders around the world use underground filter plates, and they set it up amazingly well. They basically do this. They have a tank. And it's end out, so, you know, imagine if it's a 20, it's skinny this way but long. The front half is bare glass, then they put a piece of silicone with glass in there, then they put an underground filter plate in the back and gravel over it. And they run that as the filtration, but underneath that, they had drilled a hole, so all they gotta do is turn the valve, and it sucks out all the waste from underneath the underground filter plate and sucks the gravel clean. It's genius. Why we don't do it more here in the U.S.? Most tank bottoms are tempered here, whereas around the world, most people are making their own tanks and are not tempered. But those systems are super duper efficient on massive scales with insane amounts of fish. It's hard to beat a system like that, honestly, and crazy cheap and runs off air. Like, there's so many benefits to that. So yeah, that's what I've got to say there. Looks like John from KD Tropicals made it in. Hey, you know, I'm just saying hey now because I'm like 10 questions behind at least that my mods have fed to me. So I don't want to be like, oh yeah, an hour later, finally got to it. Let's see. Kimmy Tonka, where should I position my wave maker? I already have a filter spilling water from one end, leaving the other end a bit dead. How I do it, and I don't know if this is actually a wave maker or you're just using the name wave maker in change of a circulation pump, but let's say on this end I had water coming in. I might put my circulation pump at the other end down low, but spraying towards that water to crash. So that way you get random flow patterns by water kind of crashing into each other, as opposed to if this is just doing this, you know, the hang on back filter, and this other pump is just blowing water this way. It's, you know, it does mix it, but it's not as random. But I would say this. Put it somewhere. Let it go for a few days. See where the dead spot is. If the dead spot is somewhere you like, great. It's set up correctly. If it's not, move the pump. Let it situate for another few days. See what that does. And find what you like about it. And you might go, well, I don't like having a dead spot anywhere. Okay, well, try putting another pump in where that dead spot was and see if you can get it to that point. Or an air stone or something like that. Let's see. Lord Mugat says, what would you recommend for canister? Already did that one. My bad. Sorry about that. Does that get repeated? No, I'm out of it. Okay. Adam Till, I've tried to set up a river type flow tanks and have found it tricky. Not a fan of the powerheads to sponge Hillstream type loops. Yeah, I've tried it a couple of times and I'm convinced it doesn't work well unless you use a sump. So basically, you know, you got water coming in one side, it goes all the way to the other side, and then you've got bulkheads there. It just falls down and goes back, so it creates that. Because I find that the sponges and the tubing we're using under the gravel restricts the flow enough that the water shoots faster and bounces off the wall and then gets sucked into the intake. So what I'm finding is water comes, hits the wall, stops that flow, and then gets sucked down in. What we need is the water comes and just keeps going. And so that's where I think we run into problems. And yeah, I know the Loaches Online article, I've tried to recreate it a few times, and no matter what setup I've ever done, I've never got it to work the way I wanted it to work. So yeah, that's, I think it has to be done. And I'm picking up a 240 gallon tank. I think I'm going to do goldfish with it, but if I don't, I kind of want to do a river tank. So we'll see. Let's see. Kai Burgess, is Geyer gear? I'm not sure what that word is. It's gyro, but that's not how you'd say it. Circulation better than traditional powerhead method? I don't know if it's better. It's different. So like on a circulation pump, the flow pattern is much wider typically, you know, so it's a bigger footprint, and a powerhead is much more dialed in. I think it's just different. So if this does 1,000 gallons per hour and this one does 1,000 gallons per hour, if you wanted a more broad flow pattern, then a circulation pump is better. I typically do like broader flow better just because, you know, it's that angelfish in front of the power or in front of the output scenario. One beam of really fast water, you know, the fish swimming and goes, oh God, there it goes. But very slow, fish can do it easier. Now, that being said, if you got a fish you really want to exercise, like rainbow fish or something like that, a very fast flow might be better. Let's see. I can't pronounce that name because it's not in English. But how about small nano tanks? I've got this 5-gallon with a Serra 60 liter. I feel it's not moving enough water. I'm not familiar with the Serra 60L or 60 liter, so it's hard to know. But if it's not moving enough water, I mean, are the plants not moving? Are you getting lots of settled debris, stuff like that? Add an air stone. I mean, an air stone in a 5-gallon just makes a whole lot of sense, honestly. It's cheap, effective. Yeah. Mike Murphy, is there ever a time when you would shut off your power head, such as during the day with the lights or during the night? Yeah, I mean, if I recommend turning off some of your flow when the lights are out, because that's when your fish are going to want to rest the most, typically, depending on the fish. If all your fish are nocturnal, this doesn't apply to that. But, yeah, reducing flow during nighttime can help. Now, I'm not talking about reducing filtration or your air stones or something like that, but realize you could turn the flow down a little bit in the aquarium. And think of it like your house. Do you turn lights off during the day? You do. Why? Well, it's brighter if I have more lights on, yeah, but maybe you don't need that much. And that's the same thing in the aquarium. Maybe you don't need that much flow while you're trying to sleep. You know, we don't need that much light while we're trying to sleep. So think of it that way. But I wouldn't turn it all off, you know, just because you do want stuff to keep moving around in there. All right, looks like I've caught up with my mods, so I'm going to jump to some live chat here, see where we're at. Let's see here. Let's switch it up. So we've been going for an hour. Let's switch it up to general Q&A. I'll answer questions about anything now. And I've got a few lined up, I think, from earlier. So even when you asked them earlier if they were good questions, my mods fed them to me. And they just label them as off topic. Let me scroll up here. So we've got one from Marcus Allen P. One of your female guppies died. I noticed fry in the tank the same day. Is it common for them to die giving birth? I wouldn't say it's common, But it's much more likely than other fish just because we typically see the fry. When a tetra dies giving birth to eggs, we typically can't see the eggs with the naked eye, so we just assume it died. So I wouldn't say it's any more or less. But, yeah, it's pretty stressful on a fish to have lay eggs or give birth. And then a lot of times, if that guppy was, like, newly acquired to you, it could have been already, like, trying to hang on and adjust your water parameters as it's giving birth. So, Quentin Lorenz, hi, Corey. I've been following your channel for a long time. How do you keep bacteria alive in empty cycle tanks for longer periods of time? P.S. Also planning a fish room. So, the easiest way would just be throw some fish food in there. Throw some fish food, let it rot. And yeah, that's, as it breaks down, it's going to keep the bacteria alive. Now, that being said, I run mostly planted tanks, and I just need to keep the plants alive because they're doing most of the filtration for me. So, another question, Steenfod Aquatics asks, wonders what the next talk is today at 8 p.m. Eastern time. It's going to be about goldfish, so we're going to focus on goldfish most of the time, and then we'll probably open it up at the end for general questions. So, yeah. Michael's Fisherman asks, how long are we going? I don't know. How many people do we even have in this stream? I honestly haven't even looked at all. Like, I've just been banging out questions. Let me see if I can see that answer. Looks like about 179 was our peak. So, yeah, not as good as normal. But also, it's a different skill set, or not a different skill set, but a different time for people, and they're getting used to it, so. Let's see. Mike Murphy, what's my opinion on using a Matten filter in conjunction with an FX6, similar to Rachel O'Leary on her 150 tank? I think it's all right. Basically, it just spreads out the surface area of the intake for the FX6 over a big surface area. That sponge, why I don't like Matten filters, once they do get clogged up, they're a real pain to clean. They just bomb a tank. Maddie asks if I'm familiar with the O2 grow emitter. I'm not, so I haven't tested one, so I can't really answer that question. Adam Till asks, what's the health risks of using live blackworms? Some stores won't carry them. They could harbor bacterias. Most stores won't carry them because they're too much work to clean, and they can bring in leeches and parasites and things like that. That being said, so can frozen. Frozen foods can do that too, at a lesser rate. But really, blackworms should be used in instances where they make sense. So, like, let's say you want scarlet batis and they'll only eat live food. Well, without blackworms, your options are really limited. Conversely, let's say you're trying to breed corydoras and you can't get enough protein to them. It makes sense. So use them to accomplish something you couldn't already accomplish. But if you can accomplish everything with just frozen bloodworms, you're probably better off and safer using frozen bloodworms. But that being said, like wild-caught puffers and things like that that I'm always bringing into the store, I need that kind of stuff. Or if the fish come in really skinny, I need to put weight on them quickly before I sell them, so I use them for that reason. Let's see. Unicorno Rosa, how much female and male of Liberty Malady can I put in a 25-gallon tank to start a colony? I'd probably start with like a trio or one male, three females. What licenses and permits do you need to sell fish? Usually a business license, which might be in the city you're in, and not many others, really. You know, you just run a normal business. You got to get a lot of, permits to build and things like that. But in terms of actual selling of fish, not that much. William Feltner, how often do I recommend cleaning canister filters? I have two large Sun filters on a 125 African cichlid tank. Probably at least once a month. You know, I use big intake sponges so that I don't have to clean them. I like to clean my canister filters once every 6 to 12 months, but I clean my intake sponges like every week, and that keeps me from having to break into them. And I also run my canisters so they're not meant to collect debris. That's why I use bio balls and things like that as opposed to fine polishing pads. Have I found any bottles for my mini pellets yet? Is it good for Celestial Pearl Danios? It is good for CPDs. I haven't found the bottles yet. The ones I ordered ended up not being right. I just need to order some more. Let's see. Andrew says he admires the channel and all the hard work. He doesn't even keep fish anymore and still enjoys the videos. Well, that's good. I'm glad, it's entertaining. Lord Mugat says he's used janitorial ammonia to culture bacteria in empty tank. Yeah, you totally can. You know, I just think that's too much work. You know, and you got to buy stuff. With fish food, will do the same thing. I have a 60-gallon tank, can grow snails and duckweed and pothos, but no fry will live for more than 2 days. Chemistry is perfect. What are my thoughts? What kind of fry are we talking about? It's a real open-ended question. Hi, Corey. What do we think about using table salt like sodium hydrochloride for DIY salt buffer with iodine? What is my opinion? I mean, officially, I should say, like, you shouldn't, but there's lots of people and papers that say that iodine doesn't actually hurt, especially if you're using plants and things like that that can absorb some of the iodine. So, yeah. Let's see. Danny Aquarium says, smash that like button, get 130 before we stop. Sure, Team Aquarium Co-op. Go, go, go. How to keep bacteria alive when doing filter maintenance on a hang-on back and a sponge. Keep them wet. So, you know, like typically what I do, like if I'm doing a hang-on back sponge, I take the sponge out, I clean it in a bag full of water, dump that water out, get more water, do it again, once it's clean, put it back into the hang-on back. Then I do the intake. Between the both of those, that probably takes about a minute and a half, and it should be flowing the water the whole time. I never even turn the pumps off. What's the best plant for guppies? Any, really, but guppy grass works well, but any plant, really, that you can grow will be beneficial to them. Corey, have I ever kept Geophagus guanacara? If I have any tips, I have kept them. In my opinion, though, I don't think they're classified as Geophagus anymore. Maybe it's Gymnogeophagus. But, you know, they're real mild-mannered. They take a long time to sex out and breed. But they're a fun fish. They're kind of that grayish, light, powdery blue with a black on them. They're fun fish. I don't know that I would race out to get them again. But, yeah, I like them. I've done it. I went through a real heavy Geo phase for a while. And they do well with Geos, so... How do I move 7 large fish tanks when you're moving to a new house? Depends on how large they are, but one at a time. And typically I find the best way is buy one new fish tank that's of equal size, set that up at your home, move some filtration, then move all the fish. Now you've got a spare tank and filtration at home. Do it one tank at a time, maybe one day at a time. If you try and do multiple tanks, stuff like that, it can be real hard. If you're moving a really far distance, sometimes you just don't have an option, and you might need to get rid of some fish. I did take a couple drinks of Mountain Dew. I haven't taken any water yet today, but yeah. Well, not today, but during this. How's the bug zapper going? It is awesome. I'm in love with it. I need to, when I'm done with this live stream, I'm going to do some water changes on this tank. And then I'm going to do move some of the water hyacinth that's in there because a lot of the bugs are falling on top of the water hyacinth. And, yeah, I'm going to play with that. Let's see here. Corey, no, because when I put my betta in the betta barracks, their fins close and I treat them with medicines. Most of the commercial betta barracks you can buy online, they're just too confined and not designed that well, and they create a lot of stress. So that's why I also don't use breeder nets and stuff like that for live bears and stuff like that. The stress that you put on them is really hard on them, so I prefer a different tank. AM Aquariums, where can you find iodine? Probably just like a medical supply store. I'm not sure why you would necessarily need it, though. Best way to split water wisteria into more plants. So it's a stem plant. You just cut it, then remove like 2 or 3 nodes of leaves off. So you've got about that much stem. Plunk that down into the roots or into the gravel and it will root out. Also, you could just cut it and let it float. When that stem is floating, roots will grow off the side and it'll look weird. But then when you plant it, that would root out also. And you could kind of chop that up into 3 or 4 sections and get 3 or 4 starts out of it that way. But floating plants, it's real easy because they're so close to light, they grow real fast, you know. So you take that stem, you let it grow, makes roots. Yeah. Kenny Oritz asks, hang on back filter, do I recommend AquaClear or Fluval C4? I personally recommend AquaClears. I don't have that much experience with Fluval C4, but I tend to be a guy that once I find a product that is dang near perfect and hard to improve upon, I'm not in a search to find something better. And so while the C4 might be better, there's things I don't like about it, and AquaClear, there's a lot of things I do like about it. So, yeah. Let's see here. What's my favorite plant to create massive cover fast? If I had to pick one plant currently, I would pick Pogostemon stellatus octopus. That's a mouthful. They call it the octopus plant. I'm this close to putting it on my website to sell it. I'm just afraid if I put stem plants, people start killing them. They're going to start leaving bad reviews, you know. Like one person, and this isn't calling this person out, but they bought like one of my snail traps. And then they said like, oh, a cardinal tetra got into the snail trap. This thing is bad. Left a bad review. When clearly the snail trap is designed to pick the width to let the snails in. So I don't necessarily think it's a trap that's bad. I think maybe the holes are set up a little too wide, or that tetra is too small to be using that device. But now, like, the only review on that snail trap is a one-star review because one guy had a bad experience. And the same thing with plants. If I ship plants and it's a stem plant and people fail with it, they're going to say, oh, Corey sells horrible plants. And the reality is not so much that. It's kind of like a restaurant in the fact that if I make a hamburger and let's say it tastes really good to 20 people, and then all of a sudden I serve it to 100 people, but 20 of those people think it's the worst hamburger they've ever had. Now I have 20 bad reviews, and that skews things overall. They think the whole restaurant is bad because 20 people had a bad hamburger. So I'm reluctant to ship things like that, but Pogostemon stellatus octopus would be my current fast-growing cover plant. Denny's Pet World. You just don't do that plastic bag thing with my sponges. Just too dirty. Fish water on the floor. Just service my sponge filter while I'm doing a water change. Yeah, you could. That's not nearly as efficient. And really, you should be using that dirty fish water on houseplants and things like that. You can always put towels down. I have a garbage can on wheels that we use at the store. You know. Also, when you lift that sponge filter out, you're letting all the debris fall back into the tank. That's just in my opinion, I would never do it that way. But, you know, whatever works for you, do that. Coconut Me asks, how to make an aquarium background stick to the back glass? You could use a little bit of soap and water. Basically use like baby shampoo, stuff like that. That's what they do window tint and stuff like that. You can buy sea gel, as it's called, I believe. There's a company that makes it. You can use tape. You can use a little bit of like cooking oil and stuff like that. But in general, I'm not big on backgrounds. I usually paint them on. Let's see. Paul Holdsworth said, I sent me a couple emails. No reply was about 2 weeks ago. I don't know, Paul. I pretty much reply to everyone within reason. There's been a few people that have just asked for like ridiculous things that I won't reply to because it's a waste of my time. Like one guy asked me, will I ship fish? Will I ship him a lot of fish? Will I ship it for free and pay for shipping? When I'm pretty clear that I don't ship fish, so why would I answer that email of like, you know, you're just asking me to do all this stuff that you know I don't do. So to Paul, send me another email. I'll try to get to it today. The only thing I can think of, maybe it went through a spam folder or something like that and I didn't catch it. But genuinely, and I think most of you in here know that I do reply to emails and comments and all that type of thing. So, you know, it'd be a genuine mistake if I didn't answer you unless you were just being ridiculous, you know. And that's the thing is I don't have time for people that are wasting my time. You know, sometimes people just say things, you know, I'm like, is there even a question there? You know, so you got to put a little bit of work in and actually make it a, you know, a coherent statement that I can read. After that, I will respond. Let's see. What do I do if my fish tank is filled with fry that are now grown up? Where do you take them? Back to the fish store? Yeah, that'd be one of the easiest ways. Donate them to a fish store. You could sell them. But yeah, I mean, most times, you know, people always go, well, I hate it when my fish breed. I love it because that usually means my tank's healthy, my fish are doing well, they're enjoying life. And the, you know, the worst part is, yeah, you got rid of some few fish, but you can give them away, you can do all kinds of things. So I think you can find a way. Unicorn Rosa says, you're using a drip system, not a bed of barracks. Well, it's hard to diagnose through a chat like that. Like, maybe you have a disease going on. I mean, if you're using a drip system, is the water being recirculated? Is the water optimal? There's things, you know, it's more than what we can just diagnose through this chat. So, do I believe that garlic is effective against internal parasites? I'm not convinced that it is. I don't think it hurts, but I think it takes a lot of garlic. I think the biggest thing with garlic is it's an attractant to appetite, so it makes the fish want to eat. I think that does help against tapeworms and the fact that, you know, it helps put body weight back on, but the studies show it takes an insane amount of garlic. I don't think it hurts, though. What is the best super glue to use with an aquarium? My recommendation is super glue brand, and then gel is what I use. And I sell it on the website. I think it's on there now. I think I put it on. And then, yeah, I sell it and use it in the store, too. But you could use, like, you could use Seachem's plant glue, which is, like, the same thing but way more expensive. That would work, too. Let's see. Nicely Media. So I'm treating a guppy colony for internal parasites and was meant to treat again on the fourth day but missed it. So I redosed on the fifth day. Is that okay? Yeah, you're probably fine. I mean, I wouldn't worry. I wouldn't lose sleep over that. Can I add sand to a tank with fish already in it? Coconut me ass. Yeah, you can if it's, you know, you want to rinse it really well. Maybe turn the filtration off and get it to settle fast and quickly. Kind of depends on the sand and things like that. But, yeah, it can be done. And I find it better, like, if you had a – I don't have anything around to show you. But if you had, like, a scoop and you fill that scoop with sand, then you put it into the water and you lower it down to the bottom, then dump it out, as opposed to just dumping it straight from the top, works a lot better. Let's see. Destiny says, you killed all your stem plants, including Elodia, Anacris. Yeah, that can happen, you know. It's all based on what the water's doing. You know, it's not uncommon to people to do that. The filter flow really adds enough movement, or is it necessary for a wave maker? I have 125 gallons with an FX6-2 wave maker, and the fish can handle. It depends on what fish. That's an open-ended question. That's like saying, I have 5 cans of dog food. How long would it feed my dog? And it's like, well, what dog do you have? You know? So, yeah. Let's see. Paul says, the fish shipping wasn't you. Well, then, yeah, it's probably a legitimate mistake that I just missed your email then. So go ahead and send it again, and I'll try, you know. That's the best I can do. Why is killing stem plants so easy? All right, yeah. So the reason it's so easy to kill them is because they grow so fast. And when something grows quickly, it dies quickly. And so imagine this. Let's say you have a tank that has no nitrates in it just because you're keeping it really clean. You know, most people water change too much, in my opinion, for a planted tank. There's no nitrogen in there. You put a plant like Anacris that, when it's growing well, can grow 1 to 3 feet a day. It goes in there, starts starving. 2 days later, you're going, it's all yellow. The fourth day later, the third day later, it's just completely dead. You starved it to death that fast. Now, you can take like a Anubias, you put in the same scenario, might take you a month to grow one leaf. It also takes like a month to kill a leaf. And most people just aren't feeding their plants enough. That's most common. Otherwise, you could have really harsh water parameters. You got pH down at 6.0. You could have pH at 9.0. You could have saltwater intrusion into the water. A lot of things. But you just kind of need to take it, you know, one plant at a time. I also noticed you say some were on anchors, some were planted in the substrate. So if you put them in like a lead weight and you bunch them together, that just kills them right off the bat. They don't want to touch each other. That just makes them rot. So that's part of it. Let's see. Charlie says, I have a 100-watt heater in a 20-gallon tank. Temperature fluctuates between 78 and 82, and I'm getting cherry shrimp, blue variegated guppies. Is this okay? It's probably okay. Try seeing if it's your light that's fluctuating it. Sometimes lighting, having the light on the tank, depending on the light, will raise it by those degrees. So check that out, too. Nicely says, I'm going on holiday for 2 weeks. I'm buying one auto feeder for the guppy tank, but for my main tank, what should I do? For 2 weeks, either need an auto feeder or you need a trustable neighbor that you can have feed and put all the food into either baggies and put the day on it and make sure they don't put 2 days worth of food in if they skip a day, that type of thing. Let's see. We'll probably stop this in about 5 minutes because I got some stuff I want to get done between these streams. And I'm starting to think, like, if I don't stop this, I'm going to stream until it's the next stream. And then I'm going to, like, die of exhaustion because I still got to go to the airport tonight. Let's see. I'm just trying to find, where do detritus worms derived from in tanks? Do they come from substrate, ADA aqua soil, or they live in fish, come out from fish waste? I'm not 100% sure, but I think the most common source is actually from plants. When you bring a plant in, they live in the substrate, and they come in on plants. It's really common for them to come in off of plants from the farms. So, yeah. Have I noticed discomfort in seeing Liberty Mollies with clear gravel? I've never kept them on clear gravel, so no, I haven't. HB unboxing. You have a 6-gallon tank, 3 zebra danios, and they are doing great. They eat all the food there is in a second. They swim back and are very healthy, but I want one more. Should I? What size tank is it again? 6 gallons? Yeah, you got some room. Me personally, I would bump it up to 5 or 6 of those guys and keep the food, the amount you're feeding, the same. You know, they tend to be a little more mellow the more you have. Do I have a favorite surface dwelling South American nano fish? Whoa. Let me think about that. Nano fish though? I'm not sure that I do. If it's got to be a nano fish, I'm trying to think. I have to think about that some more. John Zim's toying with the idea of having a tank of only Trinidad and Tobago guppies, but I don't see them anywhere for sale. Have I ever kept them? I don't think I've kept. I may have kept the Trinidads. I'd have to see a picture to know if I kept them. I've kept a lot of what I call heirloom strain guppies. The reason you don't see them is because they don't sell well, and most people, and this is just most. Most people want, if they're going to breed something, they want them to go somewhere. Like, once you've made some, you want to be able to find them a home. And if they're not that flashy, it's hard to find a home. People get discouraged since they get rid of them. Aftershock Beta says, my question is there anything natural like a certain fish or snail that eats hair algae off plants? Yeah, there's a bunch, actually. But the most common ones are going to be, like, Florida flagfish, Siamese algae eaters, a mono shrimp. Those are the most I can think off the top of my head. CP in the city. I'm experimenting with Lucky Bamboo to keep down my nitrates. They were really high. Have you tried it before? Yeah, I totally. I've got some tanks. I've got it in the tanks at the store. I haven't done any tests to go like 2 feet of bamboo reduces nitrates by this much each week or anything like that. But I do use it and I have played with it. Let's see. Talking about plants, how do I feel about tissue plants? I think they're fine. I think... I'm trying to think how to say this. I think they're horrible in the fact, like, for a store for me, I don't have the time to teach someone about tissue culture plants, which that means telling them they're going to melt back. Most of the tissue culture plants want high light, CO2 injection, things like that, and they're the rarer plants, right? Whereas like a hobbyist online, they can self-educate and they can do pretty well with them. And that's why a lot of stores don't carry them. The tissue culture plants have been around for probably the past 10 years in the hobby. I've seen them come and go several times. They never make it because when someone walks into my store and they want, let's say, Java fern, I could sell 150 potted Java fern, just like normal Java fern out of a tank, for every one tissue culture I would have ever sold. Because people go, that's not even water. I'm not buying that crap. How dare you? I'm offended. So I think they're good, and I think they're okay. I think they're overpriced. That's the other thing, too, is they're more expensive than a normal plant. So trying to sell just a general customer like, yeah, it's more expensive, and here's the couple of benefits, and it's going to be harder for you is a hard sell, I find. Paul says the gist of the email was he's starting fish wholesale business in the UK. Well, looking into it, what do you think the nearest to me is in Manchester, 50 miles? They have a bad reputation. I mean, I would say go work at another wholesaler before you start it. You say they're bad, but have you worked for one? You know, like that. You, for all you know, you might go work for 2 or 3 different wholesalers. You go, wait, they're actually the best. Everyone's got this illusion that they think they can do something better. Like, oh, they're doing it crappy. But you might not realize that, okay, so to do what they're doing, maybe you have to serve 5,000 stores and you're touching 500,000 fish every week. And then you're going, at that volume, it's going to be crappy. And that you might look at it going, well, McDonald's makes really crappy hamburgers. Yes, but look how many people they serve versus the best place in the UK makes this hamburger and it's more expensive and better. Realize what is their target clientele, because different wholesalers have different target clientele. Some here locally to me, they basically only exist to fulfill PetSmarts, Petcos, Walmarts, things like that. Then there's other ones that supply mom and pops. There's others that sell online. But I feel like if you're going to start a wholesale fish business, you better have worked in one and really know how are you going to do it better. You know, what if you find out the reason their fish are bad is because there's not very good flights coming into the country that allow you to do it or something like that. So I would really do my research before I would just instantly think I can do that better. All right, we're past the time. I'm going to wrap this thing up. You know, like if you haven't already, aquarium circulation and then the general Q&A afterwards in about 3.5 hours. Is that right? Let me do the math. 3.5 hours from now, we're going to do a video just like this on goldfish. So if you're still up, you know, some of you guys got to go to bed. I realize the rest of you in the U.S. are probably going, oh, I'll still be awake, but I'll be here in 3.5 hours. I want to get a water change done on this. I want to do some more things, film a little bit more, but I'm going to cut this off because I want to actually get some rest, you know, and at least stop talking, rest my voice before the next, you know, 2 hours or hour and a half or whatever I do. So thanks for hanging out, guys. We'll see you next Sunday at 3 p.m. Eastern again. Also, we're going to see you later tonight if you're hanging out. So we'll see you there. And now I just got to flip over and stop this. Thanks again, guys. We'll see you later. Oh, I thought I stopped.